Hello everyone, welcome back to the last tutorial today. In this tutorial, we will talk about regularization with linear regression and logistic regression. Okay, before introducing regularization, let's revisit overfitting on day three. On day three, we showed that in linear regression model, when data sample is small and the distribution of sample data is far from the true data distribution, the linear model could overfit to the data, resulting in a bad estimate. The distribution of these blue dots in the figure doesn't well represent the true data distribution, which are these gray dots. Thus, the model fit is quite different from the true model. And we say overfitting happens when we have less data. Moreover, we also show that in polynomial regression, when the polynomial order is high, which means high model complexity, the model could also overfit to the data, resulting in a bad estimate. For example, this two model is second order polynomial. The data sample is large, but with noise. So the 10th order polynomial tries to fit as many data points as possible, thus overfits to the data. And we can summarize this situation as more features. In general, overfitting happens when we have less data and more features. To overcome overfitting issue, people use regularization. It shrinks the parameter theta in GLMs towards zero, thus it can reduce overfitting. Here is some intuition with an example using linear Gaussian model. When the matrix X has more features than data points, D is larger than N, so it's a fat matrix. Assume we have some true parameter theta plot as follows. Each element in this vector theta corresponds to a feature from the input X. We use this theta and X to generate some data Y and fit a linear Gaussian model using MLE. MLE is calculated with this closed form solution, and we can plot it on top of the true theta to compare. We can see that theta MLE adapts to reflect quirks of training data, and this estimate doesn't well generalize to other data, even sample from the same true model, since noise doesn't repeatedly occur in any data sample. So one intuitive way of improving the parameter estimate is to surprise these large theta values. Thus, people come up with this L2 regularization, which is also known as rich regularization. It penalizes squared parameters and surprises all features, formally written as this. We add a penalty term to the log likelihood. Maximizing the log likelihood L prime will lead to minimizing the magnitude of theta I, but theta won't be minimized all the way to the zero, because when theta is equal to zero, it might result in a small likelihood term, the log of L. Thus, the maximization of L prime is a balancing between these two terms. Beta is named as hyperparameter in regularization, and with such a penalty term, the estimate of theta would have smaller magnitude, thus generalizes better. Now let's briefly talk about how we derive the estimate when we have this additional penalty term to the linear model. Formally, if log likelihood is linear Gaussian, we can write the new log likelihood as follows. We should be familiar with this function now. The first two terms are from the linear model learned on day three. The only new term is this beta multiplying theta transpose theta. We then differentiate the entire function and set the gradient to be zero. If you couldn't figure out the derivation at the first glance, that's fine. All you need to know is this closed form solution. We can compare this with the MLE solution without the penalty term, and we can see the only difference is that we add a diagonal term to the covariance of input features now. Mathematically, if X has more columns than rows, which means the number of features in the input X is more than the number of data points, the covariance X transpose X is a low rank matrix now, and adding this diagonal makes the matrix full rank, thus the inversion is more stable. Another popular regularization is L1 regularization, which is also known as lasso regularization. Different from L2, it penalizes the absolute value of the parameters and thus encourages sparse solutions. The L1 penalty pushes many features weights to zero and effectively selects informative features. Here is the mathematical form, and here is the estimate from L1 penalty. You can see many features weights are now zero. And we thus mitigate the issue of more features than data samples by throwing away some features. The log likelihood of linear Gaussian with L1 penalty is very similar to L2. I'm not going into the derivation here, but all you need to remember is it doesn't have a closed form solution, even for linear Gaussian model. The reason is the absolute value of theta is non-differentiable, thus we need optimization to feed the model. When we feed the model, we're talking about feeding for theta only, not include a hyperparameter beta. In practice, we need to select different beta values using cross-validation. Here I'm showing some results when beta has different values. When beta is very small, the penalty term can be ignored, thus the estimate looks very much like the MLE estimate. When beta is 0.1, all parameters are squashed, with some zero values appearing. When beta is 10, many parameters are squashed to zero, and when beta is 100, most of the parameters are zero now. Thus, we need to use cross-validation to select which beta actually gives us the best estimate of parameters, similar to the idea of using cross-validation to select the optimal polynomial order in polynomial regression. Similarly, we can add L2 or L1 penalty to the log likelihood of logistic regression as well. I'm not going through the math for that. Here I'm showing a data fitting example for logistic regression plus L2 regularization. We have a binary classification problem. The output y is 1 or 0, and the input x is two-dimensional, thus we have two weight coefficients, theta1 and theta2, color-coded here. We vary the hyperparameter beta from small to large, shown in the x-axis. We can see the magnitudes of these two coefficients decrease gradually all the way to zero together. Thus, there's no feature selection with L2 penalty. It doesn't prefer one over the other. We also plot the accuracy performance on the test data given different beta values. We can see the accuracy increases a bit, peaks at about beta is equal to 1, and then decreases as beta continues increasing. Then, based on this optimal beta value, the optimal theta1 and theta2 are picked with beta is equal to 1. Thus, without doing model evaluation on the test data, it's really hard to figure out which theta parameters are the best in practice, because theta are different given different beta values. Here we show another example for logistic regression plus L1 penalty. Still, we have a binary classification problem. The main difference now is that the magnitudes of these two coefficients decrease to zero, but not in a synchronous manner. Theta2 becomes zero earlier than theta1. Thus, after theta2 reaches zero, L1 achieves feature selection by throwing away the second feature. We also plot the accuracy performance on the test data given different beta values, and we can see the accuracy increases a bit, peaks at beta is around 0.8, and then decreases as beta continues increasing. Then the optimal theta1 and theta2 are picked when beta is equal to 0.8, where theta1 is about 1.5 and theta2 is 0. Therefore, this solution is sparse. Okay, so in the following notebook, you will see how the hyperparameter affects model fitting for logistic regression with L1 and L2 penalties. You will run cross-validation to select the optimal hyperparameter beta for both L1 and L2. Hope you all enjoy